Hello everyone, Gyosh on this side. So today hand we are dealing with a topic called as concept of balanced diet. So let's get started. We'll call this as nutritive requirement as well. Okay. So now let's start. Now, first of all, we should know what's the meaning of nutrition. So here, nutrition is a basic prerequisite to sustain the life. So basically, if I'll be going for, like, the nutrition is one of the most important element in a living being's life. Okay, deal with. Now, here, the variety in food is not only the spice of the life, but also the essence of nutrition and health. So basically, we on the daily basis, we are consuming different types of food. And ultimately, majority of them are composed of either the combinations or the pure form of lipid, protein, and the carbohydrate. We call them as combinedly called as LPC. Combinedly, we call them as the LPC. Okay. Now, here, what is a diet? So here, a diet consists of several food groups which provide all the required nutrients in the proper amount. A diet consists of several food groups which provides all the required nutrients in proper amounts. Okay, now here, nutrients that we obtain through the food have vital effect on physical growth and development, maintenance of normal body function, physical activity, and health. The nutritious food is needed to sustain the life and activity. So basically, our diet should provide all the essential nutrients. In their respective requisite amounts. Required amount should always be present in a proper diet. So here, the requirement of the essential nutrients may vary. With age, gender, physiological status, and the physical activity. Okay, we'll be talking about this after some time. Now, dietary intakes lower or higher than the body requirement can lead to either undernutrition or overnutrition. So if somehow you are taking lower amount of diet than the body requirement, then you will be suffering from undernutrition condition, and that is also called as deficiency diseases. One other name for the undernutrition is called as malnutrition. Okay, deal with. And if you are taking any amount of food which is higher than your body requirement, so you will be suffering from overnutrition. Now, eating too little food during certain significant period of life, such as infancy, childhood, adolescence, pregnancy, and lactation, and eating too much at any age can lead to harmful consequences. For example, I am taking only one single example here. If a child, that is what we call as an infant, the child ultimately, if a child is suffering from malnutrition, ultimately the most important reason for that is he is not getting enough amount of food, or rather if he is not getting the amount of the carbohydrate, lipid, and the protein in a proper balanced fashion. Okay. Deal with. Now, the special biomolecules which are present in a diet, are called as lipid, protein, and the carbohydrate. So, starting the first one, called as carbs, or we call it as the carbohydrates. Here, we do know that the carbohydrates are either, they are simple or complex. And the carbohydrates are the major source of energy in all human diets. The major source of energy in all human diet is the carbohydrate. And the amount of the energy which is produced by 1 gram of carbohydrate is 4 kilocalories. The amount of energy produced by 1 gram of carbohydrate is 4 kilocalories. Please do remember this. Here, starting the first thing first, the simple carbohydrates. So here, the simple carbohydrate, that is glucose and the fructose, the simple carbohydrate, that is glucose and the fructose, are found in the fruits, veggies and honey. Fruit, veggies and honey. One thing I should mention here, that hopefully you do know, but still, here, this fructose, okay? Now, if I'll be talking about fructose only, like honey is considerably having a huge amount of the fructose as compared to other food sources, okay? Please do remember that. Now, the other one, sucrose is present in the sugar and lactose is present in the milk. Whatever the sugar we call as a table sugar, that is our day-to-day life sugar, that is properly made up of sucrose, whereas the sugar present in the milk is called as a lactose, which is a disaccharide made up of glucose and galactose. This all thing was about the simple carbohydrates, rather starting with the complex carbohydrates now. Complex polysaccharides, they are called as a starch, they are called as a starch in cereals, millets and pulses. Cereals, millets and pulses, and the root vegetable and glycogen in the animal food. The root vegetables and glycogen in the animal food. Okay. The difference between starch and the glycogen is that the starch is the stored food material in the plants, whereas the glycogen is the stored food material in the animals. But basically both of them are long polymer of glucose molecule itself. The basic difference between the starch and the glycogen will be that the starch is a long chain of glucose molecules, whereas the glycogen is a branched chain of glucose molecules. Okay. Now, here, the other complex carbohydrates which are resistant to digestion, in the human digestive tract are cellulose in vegetables and whole grains and gums and pectins in vegetables as well. So basically cellulose and pectin are resistant to digestion. Now if you will be asking like why they are resistant to digestion, so basically we do not produce their digestive enzymes, specifically about the cellulose. So hopefully you do know, but still I am giving you the name of the enzyme which is responsible for the digestion of cellulose is called as cellulase. Okay. Now, and the pectin is also present in the cell wall composition of fruits and vegetables. So deal with that case as well. Now, basically they constitute the dietary fiber component. And if I'll be speaking about India, so in India, 70 to 80% of total dietary calories are derived from carbohydrates. They are derived from carbohydrates which are present in the plant food such as cereal, millet and pulses. Okay. Now speaking about the dietary fibers. Here, the dietary fiber delays and retards the absorption of carbohydrate and fat. So basically, if any dietary fiber is present in the food, that will be delaying the process of digestion and increases the satiety. So basically, what is the meaning of satiety? It is nothing but the feeling of fullness. Okay. So if you are feeling the satiety, ultimately that will be like you won't be needing to eat. Like here, I can literally give you that satiety is the feeling of fullness. Now, diets which are rich in fiber, Diets which are rich in fiber, they reduce the glucose and the lipid in blood. They reduce the glucose and the lipid in the blood, and they'll be increasing the bulk of the stool in the excretion. They'll be increasing the bulk of the stool. Now, if the diet is rich in the complex carbohydrates, that are healthier than the low fiber diets, which are based on refined and processed foods. So, our healthy diet should have dietary fibers in that, as well as the complex carbohydrate as well. Okay. Now, proteins. Proteins are primary structural and functional components. Of every living cell. Almost half the protein in our body is in the form of muscle, and the rest of the protein is in the form of bone, cartilage and skin. Okay? Deal with. One more thing, that the proteins perform a wide range of functions, and the amount of the energy they provide is 4 kilocalories per gram, which means 1 gram of protein can yield as much as high energy, 4 kilocalories. Okay? And one more thing, that majority of the proteins are also acting as enzymes. You do know, or maybe like you have heard this sentence, that all enzymes are proteins. Now, more proteins are required by the growing infants and children. Pregnant women and individuals which are suffering from infection and illness. So ultimately, again, more proteins are required by growing infants, children, pregnant women, individuals during infection and illness or stress. Animal food like the milk, meat, fish and eggs. Plant food like pulses and legumes are rich source of protein. Now, dealing with the animal proteins here. The animal proteins are of high quality, as they provide all the essential amino acids in right proportion. While the plant or the vegetable proteins are not of the same quality because of their low content of some of the essential amino acids. However, a combination of cereals, millets and pulses may provide most of the amino acids, which complement each other to provide better quality proteins. Okay? Now, fats. So here, fats such as butter, ghee and vanaspati. Basically, vanaspati means the plant fat. Okay? Vanaspati means the plant fat, and the butter and ghee will be animal fats. They constitute the dietary visible fats. Okay? Now, they are the concentrated source of energy, which provide you 1 gram of the fat can yield up to 9 kilocalories of energy. 1 gram of fat can yield up to 9 kilocalories of energy. They are made up of fatty acids in different proportions. Some of the examples I can give you, like palmitic acid, oleic acid, linoleic acid, linolenic acid, and arachidonic acid. Now, here, the dietary fats are derived from two different sources. That is, the invisible fat which is present in the plant and the animal food, and the visible fat which is added somehow, called as a cooking oil. Cooking oil is the visible fat. Now, they serve as a vehicle as well. They serve as vector for the fat-soluble vitamins. They serve as vehicle for the fat-soluble vitamins like A, D, E, K. I call them as the combinedly A, D, E, K and carotenes. A, D, E, K and carotenes. And they are responsible for the promotion of their absorption. The fats are also the source of essential polyunsaturated fatty acids. Here, it is necessary to have adequate and good quality fat. It is necessary to have adequate and good quality fat in the diet with sufficient polyunsaturated fatty acids. Now, what does this unsaturated means? Which means, whenever the word unsaturated is coming, which means all the valencies of the molecules have not been filled. All the valencies of the atoms have not been filled, and either they are sharing double or triple bonds in their molecular structure. Now, here, for meeting the requirement of the essential fatty acid, the type and the quantity of fat in the daily diet influence the level of the cholesterol and triglycerides in the blood. So basically, like one thing we should know, like about the triglycerides, like they are the proper lipids. Okay. Now, diets should include adequate amount of fat, particularly in the case of infants. So, like we should give like the adequate amount of, more than sufficient amount of fat to infants and children as well. Why? Because they are in the growing phase, correct? They are in the growing phase to provide the concentrated energy source to them. Since their energy need per kilogram body weight are twice of adults, the energy need per kilogram of the body weight are twice than of adults. So please do remember this. Now, adults need to be cautious to restrict the intake of the saturated fat. And what is the saturated fat? It is a butter, ghee and hydrogenated fats. Please do remember one thing, that the saturated fats are solid in structure and whereas unsaturated are liquid in structure. Okay? Please do remember. Now, cholesterol here, like ultimately it will be found in the red meat. It will be found in the red meat, eggs and organ meat. Now, the excess of the substances could lead to obesity. Now, what does this obesity means? Which means increased weight ultimately is called as obesity. Now, diabetes as well, the irregular control of the sugar in the body, blood sugar specifically, and cardiovascular diseases, and ultimately, eventually, it may lead to cancer. Now, talking about the balanced diet, it provides all the nutrients in required amount and proper proportion. It can easily be achieved through a blend of the four basic food groups. Now, the quantity of the food needed to meet the nutrient, may vary with age, gender, physiological status and physical activity as well. So here, a balanced diet should provide 50-60% of the total calories, 50-60% of the total calories from carbohydrate. Why? We'll be checking in the next topic. Preferably from the complex carbohydrate. About 10-15% of the protein and 20-30% from both visible and invisible fat. invisible fat. In addition as well, a balanced diet should provide other non-nutrients as well, such as dietary fiber, antioxidants and phytochemicals, like the chemicals which are present in the plants will be called as phytochemicals. Now, here, what does this antioxidant means? So basically, they are the substances that can prevent or slow damage to the cell, which are caused by the free radicals. So basically, they are the free radical scavengers. Whatever like the amounts of the free radicals which are circulating in our cells and the tissues, these antioxidants will be killing those free radicals, and ultimately they will be saving our cells. They will be saving our cells from damage. Done? Okay. Now, here they have gone for some names as well about the antioxidants, such as vitamin C and E. The antioxidants such as vitamin C and E, even the beta carotene, riboflavin and selenium. They protect the human body from free radical damage and other phytochemicals such as polyphenols, flavones, etc., etc. It also affords the protection against the oxidant damage. Spices specifically like the turmeric and the ginger along with garlic, cumin and the cloves are rich in antioxidants. So basically, being an Indian, I should say that we are ultimately getting a lot amount of the antioxidant in our day-to-day life, because we are using a lot of types of different spices in our diet. Okay. Now, the last but not the least part called as a respiratory quotient. Basically, the respiratory quotient is the ratio of carbon dioxide by the amount of oxygen consumed. So basically, in simple words, I can write it down here. It is the CO2 evolved upon O2 consumed. Please note this down. If you are literally preparing for the competitive exam, please note this down. The amount of the CO2 evolved upon the amount of the oxygen consumed is called as respiratory quotient. It's called as respiratory quotient. Now, it is used in the calculations of basal metabolic rate. That is what we call as a BMR. When we are estimating it from the carbon dioxide production, but still basic like the ratio is the amount of the carbon dioxide produced by the amount of the oxygen consumed by the body. Here, the metabolism consists solely of the lipids. So the respiratory quotient will be 0.7. If the metabolism consists solely of the protein, the respiratory quotient will be 0.8. And for only carbohydrates, it is 1, like C6H12O6. So ultimately, you will be going for the amount of the carbon dioxide evolved upon the amount of the oxygen used will be 1. CO2 upon O2 will be ultimately 1 here. But majority of the time, being an Indian, I should say that our diets are not only included on the protein, not even on the carbohydrate, and not even on the lipids. Rather, we are dealing with the mixed diet. So the approximate RQ of mixed diet is 0.8. The majority of the time, the energy consumption is composed of both the fat and the carbohydrate. So basically, I should say that the mixed diet is having 0.8 RQ. Again, going for a brief revision here. The RQ for lipid is 0.7. The RQ for protein is 0.8. And the RQ for the carbohydrate is 0.1. whereas the RQ for the protein is 0.8. I'm sorry, the RQ for the mixed diet is 0.8. Done. Hopefully this lecture has been beneficial for you. Thank you.